Anyway, let's go to part two, because I'm in a really funny and angry mood today. Fujifilm is not the only culprit in the industry. But this guy made a video a few weeks after the camera was released, and he posted pictures from other users who had just bought the camera, and they were reporting bent titanium plates, where the gap between the titanium plate and the camera body was so large you could pass in a spatula. And then you had the glowing EVFs, and Fuji released a firmware update to fix that. A firmware update is applied to all cameras, which means they all had the same problem, it's just that some of them showed it earlier than others. So what was Fuji's mistake, in my opinion? The mistake was that they listened to the YouTubers and the commentators in the forums. And that's how they designed this camera. They listened to the wrong people. YouTubers and forum writers were taking really boring images with the X-Pro 1 and the X-Pro 2, so they thought there must be something wrong with the camera. So they suggested a different camera that's like a Leica but not a Leica, and it doesn't have a back screen because we believe in pure photography. And some others saying, well, back screen is nice for other functions, and it's got a rangefinder but not a rangefinder, and this and that. And the result was this Frankenstein of a camera in which they tried to pack so many features in such a small space, untested features, and in a very short time. So the errors were unavoidable. I say happy are the owners of the X-Pro 1, the X-T3, and the Leica owners are happy because Leica is not listening to them. Leica is like a German mother, go to your room. I will make the decisions. But the ridiculous crowd on YouTube and in forums was saying, I want a better camera, I want a better camera. And I think it was the CEO of a camera maker, I think it was Pentax, I'm not sure, it's not confirmed, who said, give me better photographers and I will build you a better camera. Thank God Nikon did not listen to me or others when designing their DSLRs. Like the D850, you see the buttons, they're not on the same line, and they don't have the same size or the same feel. They're not even on the same level. These are lower than the middle one. This is a professional setting. You can feel and find the buttons with your eyes closed. The same in the back, not in the same line, different sizes, different feel. And it's impossible to dial in an accidental wrong setting, because you need a button and a dial to change any settings.
I get into the trouble. There's actually a lot of buttons here and there, and there's a really extremely complicated menu. I don't agree with that. I think photography is really simple. It's camera is basically just a matter of getting the exposure right. So anything on a camera that doesn't have anything to do with exposure basically doesn't belong on the camera, and this one has a lot of it. So I would suddenly find that I went from black and white to color, and I didn't know what button I pressed. And I find out I have a wheel here, I have a wheel here, I have something here, and different buttons. I have a Q here, and I have a AF-L button here, and I also have exposure here. And a lot of stuff that, in my opinion, doesn't really belong in a camera. So what do you do with that? Well, you basically have to read the manual. And you have a whole chapter about the Q button.
The same happened with the Nikon Z7. That's why it had all these autofocusing problems. Specifically, Nikon announces early in 2018, and I remember that very well, that it will have a mirrorless camera in the spring of 2019. Nikon users threatened with suicide and that they will all switch to Sony. So Nikon rushed the release for late 2018, pre-orders through the roof, autofocus problems, IBIS problems with some copies, which Nikon fixed by taking back the cameras and replacing them or fixing the problem. The rushed design didn't allow for anything more than firmware patches. The user still disappointed by the single card, and then Nikon released the Z7 II with two cards but a unique new battery to run two processors and slightly better autofocus. The Z7 and Z6 are out of production. The users are still unsatisfied and they expect now the Z8 to save their lives. While the D850 is still in production at the same price as the Z7 II, and it's compatible, the D850, with all the batteries that Nikon ever produced for this line of cameras. And Nikon users are now still buying the D850. After they convinced Nikon with tears in their eyes a few years ago to issue a mirrorless camera because their lives depended on it. So my message to camera manufacturers is, please stop listening to users from YouTube and forums. These people are going to bankrupt you. Listen only to the practicing professionals. So here is another factor now that came up. Your income may be up 5% if you got a raise and if you were not fired by Amazon or Meta, Facebook or Google. Google is also firing about 11,000 people as we speak. But inflation in food and gas is up 30%. And your rent probably has an inflation of 15% as we speak. Meaning that your net income is down by about 20%, your disposable income, or your net income in total. And I don't care what the government indicators say, because GDP, for example, also calculates government debt as part of the GDP. So you should not be looking at the GDP because it's not none of your business. You should be looking at your own income. And if your net income, due to inflation, is down by about 20%, this is not a recession, it's a depression by definition. 20% in 1 year or 2 years, that's a depression. So now you have so many users saying, I'm gonna sell my gear because I discovered that the iPhone 14 is just enough, or that my crop camera with a kid's zoom lens is just enough, and I don't need the fanciest and the latest. And that leaves camera manufacturers holding the bag, because designing and issuing a new model or a new series, that's a very, very serious commitment. It costs a lot of money. It puts the company's life at stake. Just because the users all of a sudden have a new fashionable lifestyle idea, because don't tell me that the X-Pro 3 is not a lifestyle camera. It's a lifestyle camera. All of a sudden, we are filled with street photographers who are trying to mimic Bresson, and their pictures are terrible and the most boring stuff you've ever seen, like the corner between two buildings, a chair left in the middle of nowhere, shit like that, that nobody really cares. And that's why they never bothered to use flash or learn about lighting and all that stuff, because they don't care about the photograph. They just want to walk around with some fancy gear. Or they say, well, I want to be known as an artist. Got nothing else going for me. But art is really difficult and takes years. So I'll just buy a camera like Bresson. And, you know. And of course, if you get the same camera and stuff, if somebody could reproduce it for you, you would find a million flaws on it. And you would start thinking, oh, I want autofocus, oh, I want this, oh, I want that. And all of a sudden you have a lifestyle camera, but you still do not have the subject. And you don't have the eye either. The guy was a painter. He could compose in an instant. And also people back then, if you took their pictures, they wouldn't be chasing you down the street to have you arrested or something. Times have changed. The lifestyle-induced photographers with expensive gear were like a woman dressed with $100,000 fancy clothes, but she has no date and no event to go to, so she ends up going to Walmart. The other category was the performance club, in which I belonged. I had performance gas. Until we went on a trip to Michigan, long one, on which I carried 3 cameras and 10 lenses, I think, 9 or 10 lenses. And we shot every possible scenario to realize at the end that I could basically do the same with only 3 focal lengths, the exact same images. So I started unloading lenses after that. And today, if you ask me, I'm more itching to keep selling than buying anything new. Because I see the lenses that I prefer to carry, if I can carry only one or two, and I have to choose carefully, and I also see which lenses and which cameras produce the most prints. So the other ones, what the hell are they doing? The other thing that I realized is that I didn't really care about bird photography, but if I wanted bird photography, it would be more like this, with a bird, let's say, sitting over here. A bird in its environment, something like that. Close up, I don't really care. I'm not into ornithology and stuff. Or a deer eating an apple. Nothing more than touristy stuff and completely incidental. But to enjoy the result and the process more, you have to pick 2 categories in which you can become really good. And then you configure what kind of gear you need. And the better you become, the more you enjoy it. Do you enjoy reading a book more if you have perfected the skill of reading? Yes. If you don't know how to read, you cannot enjoy a book. Do you enjoy writing a book or writing anything, a letter, if you have perfected the skill of writing? Obviously. You cannot enjoy writing even half a page if you don't know how to write. Do you enjoy photography more if you have more control over the camera? And if the answer is yes, then why do you need the new model that has more automations? The automations we already have in the cameras are not enough. Modern marketing and all this funny indirect pressure from YouTubers has made people a little bit of lunatics, because you have the same person writing to you in a forum that, you know, I would like the new model because it's got better auto this and auto that and auto the other thing. And the same person, in the same conversation, 5 minutes later, says, you know, I'll probably get a Leica because I will take it slowly and control the process. The same person in the same conversation. Lunacy. Speaking of skills.
So you want to make sure you keep the pull at the edge of your knees. Let's say that bottom hand can't reach all the way up just yet. Then you're going to inch that bottom hand little by little until you can reach over that top hand, then keep going until you can place that new bottom elbow behind the pole. Another common mistake is letting that bottom arm slip off the pole. So you need that bottom elbow to push your body away from the pole so you have that space to scoot your knees up for the next climb. When that forearm slips off the pole, your knees have nowhere to go. So this is why you want your hips back away, forearm pushing against the pole, so you have the space to scoot your knees up for the next climb. A few other common mistakes I've seen.
And by the way, exactly 30 years ago, I was doing panning with my film camera. Everybody was doing panning. Everybody knew how to do panning. You just place the subject in the same place in your viewfinder and you follow it. And you take the picture. And you don't need 2/1000 of a second. Do you guys still do that, or you expect the camera to follow the subject with a little square in the back to go back and forth and all over the place? Because if you ask me about bird photography, this is the future of bird photography. Drones. The drone that will follow the bird. The bird photographer will say, but there is no pleasure in that. And I will say, so you're trying to tell me that pleasure is associated with skill, but right now your only skill is to carry the gear on the field and just point the camera at the bird and set the AI of the camera to birds, and it will find it and track it. Imagine if the camera could not do that, but you had to focus it yourself, how much more the pleasure would be. If at least 90% of the picture was your skill, not the camera's skill, not the skill of the AI, but your skill. And if I put bird photography on Google, about half the pictures are birds that are sitting somewhere. It's not like they're flying around like crazy. In half the pictures, they're sitting somewhere. Interesting, though, that I put bird photography over here and Scarlett Johansson came up. So pleasure requires skill, you say?
In every other way, whatever you do, you require a skill. And it's enormously important, especially for American people, to understand that there is absolutely no possibility of having any pleasure in life at all without skill. Money doesn't buy pleasure. Ever. Look, if you want to get stoned drunk and go out and get a bottle of bourbon and down it, you can't do that except for people who have practiced the distiller's art. You can't even make love without art. Where I live in Sausalito, we have a harbor full of ever so many pleasure craft. Motor cruisers, sailing boats, all kinds of things, and they never leave the dock. All that happens with them is their owners have cocktail parties there on Saturdays and Sundays, because they discovered, having bought these things, that the discipline of sailing is difficult to learn and takes a lot of time. And they didn't have time for it, so they just bought the thing as a status symbol. So, in other words, you can't have pleasure in life without skill. But it isn't an unpleasant task to learn a skill. If the teacher, in the first place, gets you fascinated with it, there is immense pleasure in learning how to do anything skillfully. To make carpentry things, to cook, to write, to calculate, anything you want. It can be immensely pleasurable to learn the discipline. And it is completely indispensable. Because look, you may be a very inspired musician. I'm not a musical technologist, you see, and I regret it, but I'm a word technologist. But I can hear in my head all kinds of symphonies and all kinds of marvelous compositions, but I don't have the technique to write them down on paper and share them with somebody else. Too bad. Maybe next time around. But you see, so far as words are concerned, I can express ideas because I have studied language. And I have worked very hard. Not that I didn't like it, I intensely enjoy the work of writing a book, although it is difficult. But it's fascinating to say what can never possibly be said. So, do you see what's happening? What you have to do, you have inspiration, but then you have to have technique to incarnate, to express your inspiration.
But you will not acquire skill because you cannot buy the more expensive camera. You will acquire skill because this is what will bring you pleasure in photography. And when your skills develop enough, well, then you're not going to need the expensive camera anymore. How much? You know, it takes only 3 to 5 days to learn how to take a basic portrait, but still professional grade. The most advanced camera can still not do this by itself to this day. So a little bit of skill goes really a long way in photography. Think about that. Thanks a lot. Bye.